Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Trinity Church in Rainhill, our online service this Sunday morning. We trust you're well, and we want to welcome you all with us this morning, and a special welcome to those who haven't worshipped with us before. If you've joined us for the first time today, a special welcome to you. This service is slightly different this morning in the sense that we've had to cut it short a little bit. We are in the process of moving house this week. Over to Rainhill, and consequently haven't had the same amount of time to be able to put together the normal service, as it were, with lots of different things, people taking part and what have you. So apologies for that, but we'll still be worshipping the Lord together. We're still going to hear God's word spoken and explained to us. And this morning we've got a visiting speaker. It's our brother Sydney Elliott from Grace Church in Halewood, well known to us at Trinity, of course. And he's going to bring us the Lord's word this morning, so we look forward to hearing what God has to say through him. But we're going to start our service this morning with a note of praise and a call to worship. Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you, and that's what we want to do this morning. Turn our eyes from where we are onto Jesus and allow him to worship, to minister to us as we worship him this morning. So let's sing this hymn together, shall we?
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you, we turn to you, hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for you, we long for you. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away. Washed away. Hosanna.
face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away.
Before the Lord in prayer, shall we? Let's bow our heads and let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning. We thank you for this new day. We thank you for this day when we come together and sing your praises and worship you. We thank you, Lord, for the day in which we call it the Sabbath, Lord. It's your day, the first day of the week, the day we come aside from our own normal things of life and focus on you. And Lord, we thank you for that. Thank you for giving us the Sabbath. We thank you, Lord, that we have this day when we can rest. It's a picture of heaven, Lord, how it's going to be after the long years of work and toil here, perhaps on the earth. And the opportunity to rest in the presence of our God for eternity. No more cares, no more worries, no more sin to entangle us. No more tears, no more pain. We thank you, Lord, there's just endless joy that we look forward to, and endless laughter, endless feasting at the table spread for us. Lord, we thank you for the glory of heaven to come. And Lord, this is a picture of it today. We may not have all of those things here now, but Lord, it is the purpose of the Sabbath, to be able to come and rest in you. And so we do that again this morning, Lord, and we thank you for it again. Lord, we thank you for the blessings of this past week. And all that you've been to us, Lord, we thank you for your provision for us in so many ways. We thank you for those around us, Lord, for giving us people who love us and care for us, our friends and our family. We ask, Lord, that you continue to bless them and make us a blessing to them in these days. Lord, we thank you for continuing health and strength, and that, Lord, you've provided for us there too. A roof over our head in this heavy rain we've had recently. For the food that we've eaten, Lord, so much that you've given us, so much grace, so much mercy. Lord, we thank you that this week again, as we've strayed from the path we should be on, Lord, at times, we thank you, Lord, that you've been here to forgive our sins and cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. We thank you, Lord, as we come with all the guilt that we carry around with us at times, we come to the cross and we know, Lord, that your word tells us that you've taken it from us and separated it from us as far as the east is from the west. What a glorious God you are this morning, and we thank you for that. Lord, we pray that you'd be with us this morning as we come to gather in worship. We pray you'd ask you, Lord, to help us to worship you. We pray, Lord, that you would lift our voices to heaven in our singing, that, Lord, our praise would and our worship would be acceptable to you. We pray, Lord, that you would give us hearts enlightened and awakened by your Holy Spirit this morning. And minds open and ears open, Lord, able to understand what your word has to say to us later on as we hear it preached to us through our brother Sydney Elliott. Lord, we thank you for Trinity Church, and we thank you that we've been able to gather this way over the past few weeks now over the internet. And we thank you, Lord, for providing the means for us to do that. And so I thank you, Lord, for everyone who's gathered with us this morning and those who will listen later on the internet. And I pray, Lord, that you would help each one of us, Lord, as I say, to connect with you this morning as well as with each other. Father, we pray for our government and those around us, Lord, who at this time are making big decisions about our futures, Lord, and how we come out of this lockdown. We thank you, Lord, for the easing that there's been. We pray, Lord, that you'd help us all, Lord, to be sensible and to do the right things so that we enable us to get over this virus, Lord, and so there's less people in the future, Lord, who will lose their lives to this horrible disease. Lord, however we think about this, we know, Lord, that despite what's gone on over the past few months, that you are still sovereign, that you still rule, and that you've been working in this time in people's hearts and lives and minds and spirits. And Lord, we thank you for that. Lord, you've taken some people from us. Lord, even though it seems to have been sooner than it should have been, we know, Lord, that in your eyes, this is the right time. This is your time. And Lord, we know that fate will wait for all of us at one point. And so we don't take anything for granted, Lord. We thank you for your gift of grace of life itself. And we do pray for those who've lost loved ones, Lord. We pray for their comfort and their peace this morning, wherever they may be. Lord, we pray for your church as it meets around the world today, Lord, on this your day. We pray that your word would be proclaimed faithfully from pulpits all over, particularly all over this nation and this city of ours up here in the Northwest. And we pray, Father, that your word would not return to you void, and that you would accomplish its purpose in the hearts of men and women and boys and girls this morning. Father, we pray that you give us wisdom as we seek to look at ways in which we can perhaps gather again in the future, as the lockdown eases. Lord, help us to do the right thing and to honour you first and foremost, but also honour the rules laid down and the advice given to us by our government. And so, Lord, we commit all these things to you. Father, we thank you that we can gather again this morning. We pray, Lord, for us as we do that, that you would be exalted in all that we do, that you would be honoured in our worship. And that ultimately, Lord, we would go away from here this morning knowing that we have met with you, the living God. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we're going to sing again this morning, and it's one of our favourites. I think it's one of your favourites too, about God being our lighthouse. And that's what he is, isn't he, this morning, as he leads us safe to shore. And that's what he's going to do as we go through our life if we trust in him. So let's sing this song together, shall we, this morning?
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. Silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Whoa, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the dark. crystals. Hey, find me for us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. Find me for us. You're the brightest. You will lead us through the storms. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I'll follow you. Oh, my lighthouse, my lighthouse, I will trust the promise, you will carry me safe.
Well, now let's read God's word together, shall we, as we go on with our service. And we're going to look at Psalm 46. So if you've got your Bibles and you'd like to turn that up, Psalm 46. This is known as Luther's Psalm as well, as well, I'm sure we'll hear later on as Sydney explains these words to us as well. Let's read this to this morning in Psalm 46. You'll recognize this psalm as well. It's a well-known one. God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way, and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though the waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy place where the Most High dwells. God is within her, and she will not fail. God will help her at break of day. Nations are in uproar, kingdoms fall. He lifts his voice and the earth melts. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Come and see what the Lord has done, the desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars to cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. He says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord Almighty is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Well, that's an amazing psalm, isn't it? And well known to us. And we look forward to our brother Sydney explaining that to us in a few moments' time. We're going to sing again now another great hymn, O Great God of Highest Heaven. It's a hymn that reflects what we've just been reading in that psalm. It might be new to some of you this morning. So if it is, just you listen to it, maybe listen to it, rewind the tape and then sing along. It's a very easy hymn to pick up. But the words to it are magnificent and really... it's a prayer from our hearts for God to be our fortress in these days that we live in. And so after this hymn, I'll hand straight over to Sydney, who'll bring God's word to us this morning. As I say, he'll explain it to us, what we've just been reading. And then we will close with another hymn before the service finishes. So let's sing this great hymn, O Great God of Highest Heaven.
Occupy my lowly heart, own it all and reign supreme, conquer every rebel power.
let me tell you about Martin. Martin Luther. Not Martin Luther King, but Martin Luther the Reformer. A few years ago, we celebrated the 500th anniversary of the Reformation and how God used Martin Luther to kickstart the whole thing. From nowhere, it seems, he steps onto the page and stage of history, and it's basically the story of a monk with a mallet in his hand, marching through the streets of Wittenberg in Germany and nailing his 95 theses to the church door. And soon, the great darkness that enveloped not just Europe, but the whole world, suddenly, wonderfully, begins to disperse and dispel as the light of the gospel starts to shine into the hearts and lives of multitudes. Well, if you know anything about Luther, you'll know that he really loved the book of Romans. And of course, chapter 1 and the verse that says, "The just or the righteous shall live by faith." But he also loved the Psalms, and especially this Psalm, Psalm 46. In fact, it's said to be Luther's Psalm. And it was the basis of his amazing hymn, "A Mighty Fortress is Our God, a Bulwark Never Failing." Well, over these weeks, we've been looking together at different Psalms. Psalms of David, Psalms written in dark days and tough times. We spent 6 weeks in Psalm 23, and then we looked at Psalm 27 last week, Psalm 33, now Psalm 46, Luther's Psalm. And I want to take the line near the end of the Psalm that says, "Be still and know that I am God," and consider the whole Psalm through that particular lens, the lens of that phrase. It's a call, it's a command from God for us to stop at Him. I guess in these last number of months, there's been lots of stillness and quietness. The streets, the shops, the skies have all been quiet. No cars, no purchases, no planes. And we've even heard the birds singing like never before. And yet, even with so much stillness and quietness, our hearts and minds have been anything but still and quiet. Restless instead of restful. And it's so ironic, isn't it? Because you see, stillness isn't circumstantial. Rather, it's to do with in here, what's happening on the inside, our inner condition, the way that we're thinking and feeling and what's going on internally. And so there's this contradiction, this paradox, as the world starts to slow and still, we can quickly find ourselves in turmoil. And that's why I want to think about this idea of stillness. What then does it mean to be still and know that God is God? Well, it's not talking about going into space. Last month, on a completely clear night, I stood and watched Bob and Doug and the Dragon capsule chasing the International Space Station across the horizon. And then later, watched and saw in the news they'd managed to dock safely. Out there in the quietness and stillness of space. Space is so still. But that's not what David's referring to. Nor is he talking about zoning out and getting ourselves into a zen-like state. No. Rather, he's referring to that which is unique to the person who's had a personal encounter with the living God. Someone who knows God intimately and individually. Listen, without this relationship with God, we can never enjoy or know such stillness. But of course, just because we're believers, it doesn't mean automatically we always have this stillness in our souls. After all, the psalm is written from the perspective of a believer who's actually being told to be still, who needs to stop and still themselves before God. God's invitation here is to his people, who may well have forgotten what it is to trust in him the way we once did. So it's for all of us. And the question is, how can we enter and step into this stillness of soul? That's what we want to know, isn't it? That's what we want to discover. Okay, notice the psalm falls into three sections. And each section ends with the word sila. Sila means pause and reflect. And each of these sections give us a different aspect of what it is to be still. First of all, peace. Verse 1, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Verse 2, therefore, we will not fear though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved into the heart of the sea. Verse 3, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble at its swelling. Selah. Fear is a problem, isn't it? It's a huge problem. And it masquerades and hides itself in lots of different forms. In many ways, it's our default position, our default setting. And needless to say, many feel fearful when faced with the realities and possibilities of life. Here, David gives us a list of some possibilities. And notice he uses the word though four times. Though the earth gives way, though the mountains be moved, though the waters roar and foam, and though the mountains tremble. Even just reading that, we feel fearful and afraid. If you go through the creation narrative in Genesis, you'll find that God separates the sea from the land and he brings order out of chaos. But David seems to describe the reversal of this. Creation is dismantling and dissolving and disintegrating. It seems like the end of the world as David knows it. It's all under threat and there's cause to fear. And yet he says, I will not fear, even though... dot, dot, dot. And listen, such a response isn't natural, it's supernatural, it's in spite of circumstances, and it's clearly and obviously from God alone. When everything militates against peace and against stillness, David is at peace and his soul is still. You remember in the New Testament, Jesus and the disciples are out on the Sea of Galilee, and there's this great raging storm, and these experienced fishermen who'd spent their entire lives on the waves are afraid, afraid as never before, and they have every reason to be. Well, where's Jesus? He's in the stern of the ship, fast asleep. They're totally terrified, but he's at perfect peace. On the night before his brutal crucifixion and death, Jesus says to his frightened followers, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. My peace. Paul writes to the Philippians, and in chapter 4, he says this: don't be anxious for anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, make your requests known to God. And then this: the peace of God that surpasses all understanding will keep on guarding your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Again, this isn't natural. It's unnatural. Better, it's supernatural. You see, we can live in light of the potentially disastrous situations we face and be scared stiff. Or we can live in light of who God is and that He is our refuge and strength and be unafraid, even though everything else destructs and disappears. We can know that He's God and be more aware of Him than anything else, and at peace. That's what it is to be still and know that He is God. So peace. But not only peace, joy, gladness and joy. I love verse 4. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. Verse 5, God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God will help her when morning dawns. In verse 6, the nations rage, the kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, the earth melts. Verse 7, the Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Selah. Most commentators suggest that David has in mind Jerusalem. Jerusalem under siege, enemy forces surrounding the city. But those inside the city are glad. In fact, they're jumping for joy. Why? Because of the river. They have a water supply, a water source. Now remember, David's talking Middle East here. He's talking Israel, talking warm weather and hot temperatures. And of course, water is absolutely crucial in that environment. The need to stockpile food is essential as well. We know all about that at the start of lockdown. But the real need in that context is for water. They're finished if they have no water to drink, obviously. I wish I could take you on a tour of Jerusalem, David's Jerusalem, and to the spring, the well, the pool of Gihon. Here it is here. Highly significant for David. It's where he stood as a teenager with the head of Goliath held high for the Jebusite guards to see. It's where Joab, his captain, climbed up through the water shaft into the city and opened the gates for David and his men to enter and take the city and make Jebus his capital and rename it Jerusalem. And it's where Nathan the prophet and Zadok the priest and Bathsheba stood as Solomon was anointed king instead of David. So all key moments in the history of Israel and in the history of Jerusalem revolving around this pool, this well, this spring, the spring of Gihon. Many years later, Hezekiah the king will dig a tunnel from this pool, from the pool of Gihon, to create another water supply deeper into the city to protect the people from further sieges. Now then, if you know the geography of Jerusalem, you'll know that there are no rivers, or at least no rivers with water to drink in and around Jerusalem. Yes, there's the brook Kidron outside the city, down in the valley, but that soon dries up in the summer months with no water supply, and it's not for drinking anyway. But the pool of Gihon flowed freely with fresh, satisfying, clean water. And that's what David's talking about. This is the river, this is the stream that makes the inhabitants of Jerusalem glad. Life-giving water, no matter what. what? Of course, David went on to use this as a picture of God himself. Just as we have Gihon, we have God. He is in the midst. The Lord of hosts is with us. And just as the water of Gihon delighted the hearts of the people, so God, in an even greater way, is our life source, our joy giver. Elsewhere in the Bible, God's often compared to water, to a fountain of delight, and to a well of salvation. In Ezekiel 37, the prophet has a vision, and he sees water flowing from the temple of God until it becomes a mighty torrent and a great river, and this river touches the whole earth. At the end of the Bible, Revelation 22, there's a river springing from the throne of God and of the Lamb, and there's the tree of life. God then is the spring, the river of refreshment and soul, source of our soul's satisfaction. You see, we can live two ways, getting our joy from things around us. That's one way. But listen, if life's like a city, what happens when we're under siege? And these things that we're looking to all run out, or we get fed up with them, or they're taken away or cut off, then our joy quickly comes to an abrupt end. So depending on circumstantial joy during a siege robs us and destroys us. Thankfully, David describes another way to live. When our joy is rooted in God and his presence, and when everything else goes, we have him. And in times of suffering and siege, our joy remains. Again, in the New Testament, in the Gospel of John, Jesus explains what it is to be a Christian. In chapter 7, he cried and he said, "Come to me and drink." And he goes on to say, when you come to me and believe in me, there will be rivers of living, gushing water. In other words, he's claiming to satisfy our deepest desires and to fulfill every longing and craving and quench our spiritual thirst and give us lasting joy, everlasting joy. And when the siege seems to last forever and circumstances don't deliver and there's nothing out there, everything we need is promised and guaranteed in him. Listen, Christian, we no longer look for joy in that which is temporary and temporal, but in that which is lasting and living, him. And here in Psalm 46, 1,000 years before Christ, this river that David speaks about is a picture of God and the gladness he gives. And as we've suggested, it points to Jesus. He is our joy. So, peace and joy. And worship. Look at verse 8. Come. Behold the works of the Lord, how he has brought desolations on the earth. Verse 9. He makes war cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and shatters the spear. He burns the chariots with fire. Verse 10. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Verse 11. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our fortress. Selah. Here David invites us to look and behold. Terms used elsewhere in the Psalms and the rest of the Bible in connection with wonder and worship. Come and behold. Look in awe and amazement. See how God has worked in history. His acts of justice and judgment, yes, but also his countless displays of mercy and grace. making wars to cease, breaking bows and arrows, spears shattered to smithereens, chariots burned to rubble, works of desolation and salvation. I guess in the history of Israel, David's thinking Exodus 14, where the nation leaves Egypt after 400 years of slavery, and before long they face the Red Sea. There's no way through, there's no way back, there's no way out, they're trapped and terrified. And as they hear the thunder of horses' hooves and the enemy approaching fast, Moses says these wonderful words, "Do not be afraid. Stand still and see the deliverance or the salvation of God this day. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you'll never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be still and silent." Wow. Desolation, yes, and salvation. And as he always does, God, he delivers. He saves the day. And no doubt that's on David's mind as he pens these verses. Stop, stand, stay silent and see, and watch and worship. Come behold his works, and be still and know that I am God. I'm still a saving God. Then this, I will be exalted in the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. I can't stress this enough. It's all for his glory. And as the Bible continues, we find everything serves this great end. All of history is his story, and it's moving in one direction. Philippians chapter 2, one day every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Ultimately, this sense of stillness and peace and joy and wonder is the worship of Christ on that great day, there and then. But for the here and now, today, it's a clear call to bend the knee and confess with our mouth Jesus as Lord, as King, as God, our Lord and our God. If you're a Christian, never lose sight of that. Never forget that. Never forget this truth. Never forget this psalm. We spoke earlier about Martin Luther. During the dark and dangerous days of the Reformation, he was discouraged and depressed. And he would turn to his friend Philip Melanchthon and say, "Come, Philip, let's sing the 46th psalm." And as they sang, his heart stirred again. If you're not a Christian yet, then the call is to come to Christ. Peace is a person. Joy has a name. Wonder and worship has an object. It's Jesus. There's no refuge or peace or joy anywhere apart from him. And maybe this is a moment for you to stop, to be still and to behold and to look to him. You realize he's a good king and you want to come under his kind kingship and his loving rule and reign and enter into his freedom and life-giving joy. You recognize that you're a bad ruler of your own life and that Jesus is better by far. So why not bow? Why not kneel where you are? Bow, kneel before him. These last weeks, lots of people are kneeling, aren't they? Kneeling in memory, kneeling to show their outrage at injustice and prejudice and racism, the sin of injustice, the sin of prejudice, and the sin of racism. This morning, won't you kneel? Kneel in humility, in acknowledgement, in repentance, and in faith, believing. Kneel at his feet. Bow the knee, confess with your mouth that Jesus Christ is your Lord. And this psalm, this verse, this stillness, this quietness will be yours. But we're going to sing Martin Luther's great hymn. It's old-fashioned with some strange word pictures. But the point is this: our God, the risen Jesus, fights for his people and wins the battle, and we win in him. A mighty fortress is our God.
Fortress is our God, a bulwark never failing. Our helper, he amidst the flood of mortal ills prevailing. For still our ancient foe does seek to work us woe. His craft and power are great, and armed with cruel hate. On earth is not his equal. Did we in our own strength confide, our striving would be losing. Were not the right man our side, the man of God's own choosing. Dost ask who that may be? Christ Jesus, it is he, the Lord of hosts, his name, from age to age the same. And he must win the battle. Try.
Well, our thanks to Sydney for bringing his God's word to us this morning, and I hope you've enjoyed our service together today, albeit slightly differently and a bit shorter. We will be gathering again tonight at 6:30. If you're able to join us, that would be great to have you with us. And we'll be finishing our series off with Simon Manchester tonight in the story of Elijah and Elisha. So join us tonight, 6:30. Lovely to have you with us. We'll see you then. Have a great Sunday. God bless. Bye-bye.